Previously, we had discussed about areolar and adipose tissues. We saw what their location was. While adipose tissue was located in the internal organs, areolar was way beneath the skin. Okay. We need to remember that the areolar tissue, if we have skipped in the previous lesson, that the areolar tissue is responsible, not the areolar, I'm sorry, it is the adipose tissue which is responsible for providing cushioning to the internal organs, okay, wherever fat is required. I gave you the example of the subcutaneous fat in the case of child. You have to remember another example that it is present for the cushioning of internal organs. Now, moving further, before we go any further to bones and ligaments, we have to get introduced to one tissue. That is white fibrous connective tissue. Just for your understanding, you have to remember that it is not at all movable, and that is present in the joining between the bones of skull. Okay, our skull bones are not at all movable, and that is because of the white fibrous connective tissue. Okay, okay. Now, moving further, we have the third type of connective tissue, that is bone, and another one is soft bone, that is the cartilage. Now, as we talked about, there has to be a matrix, there has to be cellular component, and there has to be somewhat fibers which are being formed. Keep aside the fibers. Remember what that cellular component is and what that intercellular matrix is. In the case of bone, bone provides the main, center of mass, and it is very important for locomotion. We study about it. This bone is also a connective tissue. Firstly, the matrix is rich in calcium and phosphorus. You have to remember that the intercellular matrix is rich in calcium and phosphorus. These two elements are very important for living organisms, because without them, we cannot perform basic functions. So, the calcium and phosphorus reservoir that is present in the intercellular matrix. What about the cellular component? The cellular part is known as osteocytes. Okay, the cells which are responsible for the formation of bone, that would be the osteocytes. The bones would have the cells, and there would be an intercellular matrix that would be formed of calcium and phosphorus. Talking about cartilage, cartilage is a soft bone. Now, supposedly this is a bone. It has its components, that is calcium and phosphorus, is present inside it. If we cut its transverse section, there is a canal inside it. These are having cells arranged in it. There is lot of matrix that is present, that is rich in calcium and phosphorus. On top of this bone, there is a presence of soft bone, that is the cartilage. Now, how cartilage is soft? Firstly, the cells which are present, as there were osteocytes over here, we are going to find chondrocytes in cartilage. The difference of cells, okay? These are the cells. As it had calcium and phosphorus matrix that was present and it was hard, we have over here protein matrix, okay? And somewhat fibrous matrix. So, we have protein and cellular matrix. You are not going to find mast cells over here. You are not going to find fibroblasts could be present. You are not going to find though. There would be chondrocytes. This intercellular matrix is softer as compared to the intercellular matrix of the bone. So, that is the difference between cartilage and bone. And both of them are connective, because the connection between the bone to the other bone cannot be made if it is not having this soft part. Now, the connection between one part of the other cannot be made if there is no bone. So, you can make it out that these two also are connective tissue. Now, these are the two types. The next two types that we talk about is the tendon and the ligament. Fifth one is tendon and sixth one is ligament. Now, what is ligament? We'll go to tendon also. When there is a connection between bone to bone made or established, we find the connective tissue known as ligament. Okay, first thing, that it is elastic and flexible, and it is present between junction of two bones, so that the flexibility can be maintained, and that is known as ligament. That connective tissue which joins bone to bone, sorry, bone to muscle. This is hard and non-elastic, very strong. This is bone to muscle, while ligament is bone to bone. Okay, so this you have to remember, the four more types of connective tissues that we have studied. We talked about the white fibrous tissue as well. Next, we are going to talk about the blood. And that would be the last type of connective tissue we study. What is blood? Blood is a fluid connective tissue. So what we see is that the intercellular matrix would be fluid. We're going to find few fibers. We're going to find the matrix and we are going to find the cells. Okay. So we are going to discuss about blood, and as I told you, this lymph, that is blood's derivative. So we do not study about that. We only talk about blood as connective tissue. So let's see what blood is all about. Blood is the fluid connective tissue for connecting different parts of the body, different organs. We have blood. Blood is having a fluid matrix. Now, what that fluid matrix is known as? See, make a blood smear if you ever get a chance. Try to make a blood smear and observe it under the microscope. What you're going to find is that the fluid matrix, or otherwise known as plasma, would be there, which is almost 90% of it is water. Okay, almost 95 or 90%. Plasma is there. That is the intercellular matrix. Inside plasma, you find formed elements. Now, why I use the term formed elements? Because you're going to find this term in your higher classes. Formed elements is nothing but the cellular component. Okay? The cellular component in the blood has RBCs, WBCs, and platelets. Now, we didn't find fibers anywhere. These platelets are responsible for fibers, formation of fibers that you see in the form of clots, okay? Whenever you find a cut in your body, or you get to have a cut, unfortunately, on your skin, it is replaced soon by a clot-like substance, okay? Not clot-like substance, rather it is a clot. So, that clot is formed because of platelets which are present inside the blood, and that is fibrous, you have to remember. So the fibrous part, whatever fibers are being secreted, we did talk that there are certain cells which would secrete the fibers. Either they are going to be elastin, either they are going to be collagen derivatives, or directly those fibers. So we find platelets which are responsible for forming those fibers. Talking about WBCs, WBCs are responsible for immunity, and there would be mast cells, of course, that would be present. WBCs are going to have certain other types of cells in them. Okay, they have many varieties. We have two types, that is granulocytes and agranulocytes. Now you have to remember these terms, agranulocytes. Okay, in the granulocytes we have acidophils. Not acidophils, it is eosinophils. The name is given on the basis of the dye that is used to stain them. Why I wrote acidophils? Because they are acidic basically. Eosinophils, basophils and neutrophils. The three types, you have to remember the names, okay? And in the case of agranulocytes, we have lymphocytes and monocytes, the two types, okay? Monocytes and the lymphocytes. These lymphocytes, they pass on to lymph from the blood and form that immunity part of our body. They go into the lymph, that is derivative of blood only. So this is what is all about WBCs. WBCs could be granulocytes or agranulocytes. Platelets are simply those cells which are responsible for blood clot formation. And then we have the colored component of the blood, human blood. Talk about human blood. It is having RBCs, that is the colored component. It is nucleated in case of certain animals and enucleated in the case of certain animals. Like talk about ourselves, we have enucleated RBCs. Talk about a frog, it is having nucleated RBCs. So RBCs are the red blood cells. Otherwise, the other name for these is erythrocytes. Erythro word is used for red color, okay? So the RBCs are the component of blood which give it red coloration due to presence of hemoglobin. They are enucleated, they are the most abundant, and they are replaced every 3 months. So this is about blood. When this blood passes from the capillaries, certain part of it oozes out into the interstitial fluid in the form of interstitial fluid and forms the lymph. At times there are lymph capillaries inside which the lymphocytes would go, and that intercellular fluid, that is, most of it is plasma. This plasma also contains certain proteins and derived elements that we need not to get into detail of, but you have to remember that 90%, 95% rather, of it is water. Remaining are albumin and other proteins which are present. There could be certain ions which are present inside the plasma. Then we have the cellular components, the three different components that we talked about, and this is all about the blood that you have to study.